Hello and welcome to the main show on Truth Frequency Radio and UCY TV. This is your nonstop hour of psychological whatever. Deaths due to the Chernobyl disaster. Let's talk about this. Let's talk about death. Let's talk about nuclear. Let's talk about solar. Solar, which will save us. Nuclear, which will also save us. According to the mainstream, nuclear will definitely save us, maybe. I always thought there had been three nuclear accidents. There was the nuclear accident that occurred in America in the 70s, but of course the 70s were a bad time, so it's not really our fault. Anyway, the mainstream now says that wasn't a complete meltdown, so we're kind of excused. We're kind of excused. Then there was the terrible Russian disaster. Of course, there were Russians, and there were Soviets, and they were doing terrible, terrible things. So they, you know, that's what happened, really, because nuclear power is safe. Nuclear power is safe and effective. And if you don't believe it, you're like one of those anti-frackers who believes movies like Gasland instead of important movies like Frackland. The industry-sponsored response to Gasland, which lets us know that all the people who had exploding pipes are really fine, and that water tends to explode anyway. That's right, water tends to explode anyway. Just ask the people who made Frackland. It's going to be a great economic boom, fracking. If you live in a town, a small town, and you have, you know, some tight oil, some shale under the ground that you live in, and you get your water under there in the water table, helpful fracking tools will come, helpful drills and drill men will come. Along with them, a chain of quick fast food, also strippers, prostitutes, and a healthy trade in drugs, pills, amphetamines, things like that. And that'll be a great boon to your economy for about 6 months, maybe a year, and then it will be over and you'll have no more water to drink. But boy, was that a great year. If you're an anti-nuclear person, you're like one of these anti-fracking people. And boy, I just cannot stand you anti-frackers out there posting links to studies on water quality and all this anecdotal evidence. Everybody's coming along showing that they lived in a house for a long time and now their pets are dead. Well, boo-hoo, and now they're sick with some mysterious disease. I guarantee it had nothing to do with the terribly deadly carcinogenic chemicals going in the fire retardants going into your water table. What's the worst that could happen? Not a question asked by the people who run Wall Street. What's the worst that could happen? Really never asked by anybody in industry. What's the worst that could happen? It's an important question, but not here in America, because the market rules us. The market runs us. The market tells us all. The market, that chimp cage in Lower Manhattan where greasy-haired idiots from Long Island and New Jersey come over in their vehicles through the bridges and tunnels, across the dilapidated bridges that are going to fall, killing hundreds of people one day. It'll happen. I'm not praying for it. I'm just telling you it's going to happen because our infrastructure is in ugly disrepair and it's only going to get better just by thinking about it and by talking about it and by hoping and being the change that you want to be in the world. Our infrastructure will just improve because that's how rust works. Going to the chimp cage in Lower Manhattan, where they make bets by the second in 15-minute increments of testosterone and adrenaline, powered by Red Bull. That's how we run the world. That's how America works. That's freedom. That's how we do it. This is how we do it. Now it's time to have more nuclear power. Nuclear power. Why? Even James Kunstler says we're just going to have to bite that nuclear bullet, doesn't he? So even a guy who understands the whole oil problem, oh, we're just going to have to go nuclear. It's really irrational to be afraid of nuclear because, after all, there have only been a handful of deaths from nuclear power. Let's read. The Chernobyl disaster was a nuclear disaster that occurred in 1986 that occurred in the Ukrainian Soviet Union. The scientific consensus, like the one about Big Bang theory, or HIV theory, or vaccine theory, or the DDT was really pretty safe and, you know, maybe we shouldn't worry about it, or that glyphosate is good for you, or that exploding 2,000 nuclear bombs in the atmosphere, ocean, and underground was a test. The scientific consensus on the effects of the disaster have been developed by the United Nations Scientific Committee. The UN? You don't say. The UN? Oh, we love the UN. Their peacekeepers go into countries where we need their oil. Angelina Jolie is a frontman for them. She helps them out and tells us by making important movies about how going in and, you know, never mind the drugs, sex trafficking, never mind all of that, never mind the number of killings that occurred just so that we can get something that we need to make this economy, that, you know, that Wall Street thing again. It has to work. And the you know, the market determines all. The market makes us safe for freedom. And freedom is what you buy when you go to the store. It comes in a tin foil bag and it has a little cheetah on the front. I love more freedom. Crunchy, 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 crunchy freedom. I love you, freedom. Crunchy freedom. Crunchy freedom. In peer-reviewed publications, well, thank God for peer review. I mean, where would the German scientists have been without peer review? Where would AIDS drugs, cancer drugs be without peer review? Where would vaccines be without peer review? I mean, it's just taking a couple guys whose paychecks are dependent on the same set of murderous lies that yours are dependent on and saying, will you approve of this? And they say, yeah. UNSCEAR, the United Nations, saw we have been through that, has identified fewer than 60 immediate deaths from trauma, acute radiation poisoning, and cases of thyroid cancer from original group of about 4,000 cases of thyroid cancer in the affected area. You see, there were 4,000 cases of thyroid cancer, but 60 immediate deaths, because it's radiation, and Lord knows if it doesn't have an immediate effect, it doesn't have any effect at all. That's why it has half-lives of 10,000, 20,000, 50,000. Wait a second. Other non-governmental organizations, many with staunch positions on the spectrum of the nuclear power debate, we don't like that. They have staunch positions. Have claimed numbers up to 1 million excess deaths caused by a nuclear disaster. Wait a second. You're saying that non-governmental organizations, the government, which supports nuclear power and builds nuclear power plants, having no vested interest in what people think about nuclear power, says that there were 60 immediate deaths. But independent analysts with positions about nuclear power not based on the desire to build more nuclear power plants have claimed numbers up to 1 million. Well, can we get anything about that? No, we're just gonna move on. We're not going to hear any more about why they think that. Oh, we're back to the UN. UN and other international agencies such as the Chernobyl Forum. Oh, that sounds... And the World Health Organization, they're the ones who told us that Africans who had diarrhea had AIDS, so we would give them nevirapine. Oh, thanks, WHO, killing generations of Africans. State that such numbers are wildly overestimated, stressing a need for hard documentations of death. Of course, you have to go to all the people hiding in their houses in the exclusion zones, and all the people who died of some morbid cancer with whatever religion they practice that forbids them from talking to strangers about death. Yeah, of course you can just talk to anybody about anything you want. It is thought that the principal long-term adverse... Oh, here's the important line. It's in the Wikipedia, so it must be a lie. It is thought that the principal long-term adverse health outcomes are anxiety and depression among the general public across Eastern Europe as a result of irresponsible reporting and exaggerated statements by anti-nuclear power activists. Wow. Huh. Wait a second. Anxiety and depression caused by radiation. No. Caused by a fear of radiation. Oh, now I understand. Radiation is safe. Nuclear power is safe. Nuclear power activists are bad. They are irresponsible and they exaggerate. Complicating the conflict. Oh, I didn't realize there was a conflict. I thought you were telling us the truth. I'm confused. Is the fact that... With the exception of diagnoses of acute radiation syndrome and obvious industrial accidents on site, assignment of causes of death is a statistical rather than deterministic process. Sorry, in English? Although non-peer-reviewed publications, in other words, people coming forward and saying, hey, everybody in my family's dead, is that peer-reviewed? What? No, they're over here. They're dead. Is it peer reviewed? No, they're dead. Well, it's anecdotal. I'm sorry. You don't count. Go fuck yourself. Allege a bewildering variety of cancers. Bewildering variety of cancers, heart and organ diseases. Birth defects in children and grandchildren of nearby residents and other ailments. Allege. You want to see the pictures? You can. Just look up Chernobyl babies deformed. In fact, isn't that two in facts? For the vast majority of these conditions, there's no comma there, but there should be. Radiation exposure is not even a recognized cause, and in many case, and in any case, the incidence of such conditions in the relevant population has actually fallen since the Chernobyl incident. Really? Is there a statistic? Is there a number for that? No, there's not. Is that referenced? No. Is it peer reviewed? No, it's not. Huh. So it's not true. Huh. The Wikipedia isn't peer reviewed, is it? No, it's not. On the other hand, the effects of radiation are becoming better known, as experience gathers and formerly disconnected illnesses may actually be the result of long-term unseen damage during the exposure event. Oh, somebody snuck something in there. And there is a reference. What happened to the survivors of the early Los Alamos nuclear accidents? Now they're saying maybe. During the mid-1986, the Soviet death toll rose from two, oh, you see, only two people died, to 31, a figure that has often been repeated. Repeat a lie often enough. Following the disaster itself, the USSR organized an effort to stabilize and shore up the reactor area still awash in radiation using the efforts of 600,000 liquidators recruited from all over the USSR. Some organizations, can we know who they are? No, not in this article, claim that death a result of the immediate aftermath and the cleanup may number at least 6,000. Let's look. Oh, there's a number there. Maples, David R. Chernobyl, A Decade of Despair. In the Bulletin of the Atomic Scientists. Well, couldn't we say the Bulletin of the Atomic Scientists claim or argue? Can we say argue instead of claim? That makes it sound like they're idiots. Argue, and they actually have data to support it, and they collected data? No. Yeah. For information on the indirect health implications of Chernobyl, see Chernobyl's disastrous effects on human health. Whoa. Yeah. So this article was written by what we call industry shills, and they go on the Wikipedia and they make stuff up. They make stuff up about cancer, about AIDS, which is AIDS drugs kill people. HIV tests aren't accurate. You put the two together, you get a real problem. HIV tests come up positive for anything. Look it up. HIV tests come up positive for. Go ahead. Take a break from this fun talk and go look at HIV tests come up positive for. Go ahead. HIV tests come up positive for, comma, false positives, false negatives. Look it up. Polyreactive. Go look it up. See what you get. Now I thought there were. Now that's the worst one. Of course, only two people died, and then maybe 31, and then of course also the 4,000 or 6,000, also the million. Yeah, it right? I mean, who knows? We're not allowed to know because radiation, if it doesn't kill you immediately, doesn't make you stronger. The Ann Coulter view is that it makes you stronger. That's called hormesis. Yes, radiation, if it doesn't kill you, makes you stronger. They call that hormesis. I want Ann Coulter, Bill O'Reilly, and anybody else putting this forward to take a dive into the Chernobyl area and move in. Close. See how that hormesis makes you feel. I know. I don't, you know. So there are three nuclear disasters. The Three Mile Island disaster, the Chernobyl disaster, in which 2 to 1 million people died. That's the nuclear industry. We're not allowed to know. Or, let's see, list of, let's go to the Wikipedia, list of civilian nuclear accidents. Well, there should be three. Scope of this article. Da, 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 da. Well, this is strange. It starts in the 1950s, then it goes to the 60s, then the 70s, then the 80s, then the 90s, then the 2000s, then the 2010s. Well, this can't be right. I mean, there've only been, right? I mean, the three. And the Chernobyl, it was either two people or a million, so it's that's probably two or 31 or 4,000 or 6,000. We can't know because we're not allowed to go there. It's an exclusion zone. We can't be there. What is this? 1950s? 1952. INS Level 5, Chalk River, Canada. Reactor core damaged. Huh. Fires. Radiation leakage in the uranium released through the reactor stack. Huh, that's terrible. 1958, Chalk River, Ontario, Canada. Fuel damaged. Skin cancers, etc., etc. 1958, Vinča, Serbia, Yugoslavia. Criticality excursion. Criticality excursion? Excursion? Can we speak English? Criticality... what are you going to do today? I think I'm going to go on a criticality excursion. I think I'll bring my mother. Irradiation of personnel during a subcritical... Well, that's just... I was going to say it's terrible, but it's not that bad. I'm being subcritical. What? Subcritical counting experiment? Oh, criticality when the stuff becomes hot and nothing can stop it from melting down. I get it. So criticality is the beginning of the meltdown. I get it. It's when the fuel ignites in its nuclear way of bouncing around all these protons. Blah, 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 splitting atoms, creating heat atomically by splitting atoms. That sounds safe. Saturation of radiation detection chambers, false readings, da-da-da, experimental. Bone marrow transplant. What? People got sick? Huh. Sounds like everybody, well, there was bone marrow trans. Yeah, so people were exposed to radiation and then they eventually died, but it won't say that here. Because if it's past a certain point, it's like radiation therapy when you go in for cancer. If you live past the 5 years, but if you die on 5 years in one day, it wasn't the radiation or the treatment. It was... And it wasn't the cancer either. You just died of natural causes. Really, it's like the expiration warranty running out. Well, it's 5 years and one day. Clearly, it had nothing to do with what we did 5 years ago. And one day. July 1959, Santa Susana. Oh, Susana, California, United States, partial meltdown. Stop the presses. What do you mean a meltdown? A meltdown? In the sodium reactor experiment, power excursion. Ah, we're going to go to the power excursion. We're thinking of bringing my mother. That caused severe overheating of the reactor core, resulting in the melting of one-third of nuclear fuel and significant release of radioactive bloody gases? 260 times worse than Three Mile Island? The site was cleaned up, and the soil was removed, and other soil brought in, and now forms a portion of an area near the Simi Valley Adventist Hospital. This is in Simi Valley? Right there in Greater Los Angeles? Westmoreland County, Pennsylvania? A core meltdown of Westinghouse Waltz Mill Test Reactor? Disposed of 2 million gallons of contaminated water? Disposition? The disposition? What? At least a portion of the water was retained on site in lagoons, but it didn't. I mean, it leaked into the area. 2 million gallons of contaminated water. The site is currently undergoing cleanup. Really? I thought it was 1960. Oh, that's right. The half-life of nuclear power is hundreds of thousands of years. I see. 1964, Wood River Junction, Richmond, Rhode Island. Radiation, da-da-da-da-da. Somebody died, and yeah, everybody's fine. Somebody died, but everybody's fine. October 1966, Monroe, Michigan. Partial meltdown? A sodium cooling malfunction caused a partial meltdown in Enrico Fermi demonstration nuclear breeder reactor. There was a meltdown in Michigan in 1966. Winter 1967, the Soviet icebreaker Lenin had a meltdown. It was covered up. 30 of the crew were killed. The ship was abandoned, and the fuel was dumped with 60% of the fuel. The reactor was dumped with 60% of the fuel into the Kara Sea. Hey, Norway. May 1967. Dumfries and Galloway, Scotland, United Kingdom. Partial meltdown. I thought there were only three. 1969. Lucens, Cantona Vaud, Switzerland. Explosion. Total loss of coolant led to a power excursion. We're going on a power excursion. I think I'm bringing your mother. Not your mother. an explosion of an experimental nuclear reactor in a large cave at Lucenza. Huh, so it's all sealed and buried and it's, oh my god. 1970, 1975, INES level 3, then East Germany, station blackout, power supply was improvised and blah, 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 blah. Short circuit disabled for all feed water and emergency cooling pumps. 1977, INES, that's their level, that's their, you know, whatever, DEFCON. I think it goes to 7 or 8. 7, goes to 7. Level 4, Yaslovske Bihunice, Slovakia, then Czechoslovakia. Fuel damaged. Operators neglected to remove fuel moisture observing materials, like the stuff in your vitamins. The accident resolved damaged fuel integrity, extensive corrosion and damaged fuel cladding, and release of radioactivity into the plant area. Yay! Everything's fine. Situation in control. March 1997, INES level 5, Dauphin County, Dauphin County, partial meltdown. Really? Huh. 3 Mile Island. Oh, yes. Nuclear. That's where Wolverine fought his brother in one of the movies, and then they changed his brother in one of the other movies, and then that one movie didn't really happen because he got his memory erased. That's the important stuff that Americans know about. Not the real 3 Mile Island, in which there was a meltdown. Melting down through, there was a melt of the fuel and it became uncontained and melted and hit the floor and burned through the thing. Area residents received, on-site radiation exposure was under 100 millirems. Wow, that sounds fine. Less than annual exposure to natural sources, they say. This is clever. You know, ionizing radiation is actually different than naturally occurring background radiation in the atmosphere. Ionizing radiation comes from splitting atoms and has a wildly different effect in the way that it lodges into the body than the stuff that passes through you. It's very clever, isn't it? So they're able to say things like this. Area residents received an exposure about one-third the dose from eating a banana per day for 1 year. There were no fatalities. Really? Now, if you look into the area and you see a spike in cancer death, which you do, and you look into every area where there's been a nuclear problem, you see a massive increase in aging, in mystery ailments, and you do, here's what real nuclear researchers, not getting funded by the nuclear industry, say. They, real researchers in radiation say that deaths from radiation look like deaths from everything else, but faster, earlier, too soon. That's what they'll tell you. It's not that there's, unless you're near the radiation source and then you get radiation burns and your whole body just liquefies and bleeds out in the most nightmarish tumor-covered way, death from radiation is an unzipping of your DNA slowly through your body. The stuff lodges in your cells, cannot be dislodged. I don't know if it can. And begins this long process of deranging your body. So you age. It's like heavy, heavy, heavy oxidation, but a little bit different. It's radiation. There's a reason. Marie Curie died young of a cancer because she carried polonium around in her pocket. Well, she died of natural causes. Well, only if you exclude the polonium in her pocket. Her husband died young too. You know, they worked with radioactive material. You don't have to die in a year. You don't have to die in 6 years. But if you die in 7 or 10 years and you die young and you die of a disease, it's likely that that's, you know, and there's no other cause of the disease that anybody can find. It's the radiation. So, no, the banana thing's a joke because the kind of, with a leak from a reactor, you're talking about cesium-137, you're talking about all of the varieties and the 1,000 varieties of radioactive subparticles that are released through fission. You're not talking about a naturally occurring background element in bananas. It's not even there. It's not the same thing. So they're lying. I mean, they're actually lying, which shouldn't surprise anybody. But somebody, and I guarantee that the other side can't get in here to make this argument. Look, you're not talking about the same thing. You're not talking about ionizing radiation. There's a difference between non-ionizing and ionizing radiation. Very important to look that up. What's the difference between ionizing and non-ionizing radiation? We'll have to do that on the next show because I'm not going to switch right now. We're coming to the break on the Liam Scheff Show. Let's just march through the rest of this. 1980s. Saint-Laurent-des-Eaux, France, nuclear materials leak, March 1981, Tsuruga, Japan, radioactive materials released into the Sea of Japan, 1983, September, Buenos Aires, Argentina, accidental criticality, beginning of a meltdown, good times. 1986, Pripyat, Ukraine. That's Chernobyl. 1986, Hamupt up Germany. Fuel damage. 1990s, Tomsk, Russia. Explosion. Ugh, that had to go well. 1999, Ishikawa Prefecture, Japan. Control rod malfunction. 1999, Ibura Prefecture, Japan. Accidental criticality. Beginning of a meltdown. Beginning of a massive exposure. 2003, Pax Hungary, fuel damage. The fuel's damaged, it doesn't respond properly and goes into meltdown mode pretty easily. Sellafield, England, 2005, nuclear materials leak. 2005, Braidwood, Illinois, nuclear materials leak. 2006, Irwin, Tennessee, nuclear materials leak. Fukushima, 2011. What else do we have? You need more? It's on and on and on and on and on going. These are the ones that make the official record. Now, the mainstream will tell you that they have 99 of these. 99 nuclear accidents, 99 nuclear incidents and accidents, including the 2,053 nuclear bombs set off in the atmosphere of the sea, the upper atmosphere, and below the ground in the United States, Europe, the Atlantic and Pacific Ocean, south and north, all parts of Russia. Seven or eight countries have been responsible. The United States is, of course, number one on the list, number one with a bullet. You tell me if we can handle nuclear power. If you say yes, please move to Chernobyl. You're listening to The Liam Scheff Show on Truth Frequency Radio and UCY VT. Be back in a minute. And we're back. We've been talking about nuclear accidents, the 99 lift balloons. We were told that there were three, and one of them, you know, really, nobody really died except a couple people, but all, you know, the enemies of nuclear power exaggerate that, and you can't trust them, except that you can't trust the people who are in favor of nuclear power because they're crazy. They're mentally ill. It's all government-funded. You can't build a nuclear plant without having the government take irresponsibility for it, because nobody can be insured for that much. You can never pay anybody back. It's like the vaccine industry. They are protected from all feedback, all normal feedback, all normal rules of the abnormal market. They are protected from it. That's nuclear power. Look it up. Chip Ward is a writer who writes about this kind of thing. He has an article called Long Break. Go get a drink. Chip Ward, nuclear meltdown. Chip Ward. When nuclear powers blow, the first thing that melts down is the truth. Let's go through this article by Chip Ward, how the peaceful atom became a serial killer. I think this is worth reading as an addendum, a follow-up, a part two, or in Star Wars speak, a part five. Anybody excited for the new Star Wars movie? I'm tiny little gay eighth grade erection for it. Nothing much. Why? Because I know it'll be a fun movie. And I just, who cares? We got nuclear metal. All right, whatever. I'm sure it'll be fun. But you know what? It won't stop Fukushima. And you know what? They put out three movies that just sucked. Atomic A-hole. For years, we had to tolerate this. There were two good movies. Let's be honest. There were two good movies and a couple good scenes in the third movie. And I mean 1, 2, and 3 in the 1977 through 83. At the same time that nuclear accidents were going on all over the world, which tells you something. We're a storytelling species, and we care more about stories than we do about reality. Because Star Wars gets much more attention than Chernobyl. And Chernobyl's still killing people. And it will be killing people till the end of all of our lives. And for a dozen, hundred more lifetimes. We don't care. We're a storytelling species. There's no in- somebody tried to put out a horror movie, Chernobyl Diaries or whatever. You know, oh look, let's make a horror movie around the exclusion zone. Ooh, still couldn't get people to see it. It's just too ugly. I mean, the reality is too ugly for people to handle, and the reality is that we're a storytelling little monkey that got oil and could do anything that it wanted to, and will destroy itself by splitting atoms and spraying oil everywhere. And using oil to build our food system thousands of miles away from where we eat. Our food growing system is thousands of miles away from where we actually eat. How is that going to go in an emergency? We're all dead. All dead. All dead. All starving and dead. Short period of time. Make Stalin's thing look like a cakewalk. A little happy warm-up. 40 million or 30 million dead over 50, 60 years? when America stops functioning... 320 million people going down the drain. I don't know who's going to survive, but you better start growing food. You better start growing food. Let's read this article by Chip Ward. When nuclear powers blow, the first thing that melts down is the truth. Just as the Chernobyl catastrophe 25 years ago when Soviet authorities denied the extension of radiation and downplayed the dire situation. No, what's the problem? There's no problem here. Yet. Fotografier Nils, yeah, you must go. Downplayed the dire situation that was spiraling out of control, Japanese authorities spent the first week of Fukushima crisis issuing conflicting and confusing reports. We were told that radiation levels were up, then down, then up, but nobody aside from those Japanese bureaucrats could verify the levels, and few trusted their accuracy. The situation is under control, they told us, but workers are being evacuated. No, not that way. There is no danger of contamination, but stay inside and seal your doors. Because Lord knows, radiation respects a locked door. Hey, what's behind this door? I don't know. It's closed. We're not allowed. We have to be invited in. Isn't that vampires? The bureaucratization of horror into bland and reassuring pronouncements was to be expected, especially from an industry where misinformation is the rule. Although you might suppose that the nuclear industry's outstanding characteristic would be its expertise, since it's loaded with junior Einsteins, who grasp the math and physics required to master the most awesomely sophisticated technology humans have ever created. Think again. Based on the record, the most outstanding characteristic of the nuclear industry is a fundamental dishonesty. I learned that, says Chip Ward, the hard way. No, not the very poor movie with Michael J. Fox and James Woods from the early 1990s, but the actual hard way. I learned that the hard way as grassroots activist. I know, go look it up. It's terrible. I learned that the hard way as grassroots activist organizing opposition to a scheme hatched by a consortium of nuclear utilities to park thousands of tons of radioactive fuel rods like the ones now burning in Fukushima in my Utah backyard. Oh, yeah, nothing bad could happen where you're doing nuclear tests all the time. Here's what I took away from that experience, says Chip Ward. The nuclear industry is a snake oil culture of habitual misrepresentation, pervasive wishful thinking, deep denial, and occasional outright deception. For more than 50 years, it has habitually lied about risks and costs while covering up every violation and failure it could. Whether or not its proponents and spokespeople are dishonest or merely deluded can be debated, but the outcome, dangerous misinformation, and the meltdown of honest civic discourse remains the same, as we once again see at Fukushima. He wrote this in 2011. Established at the dawn of the nuclear age, the pattern of dissemblance had become a well-worn rut long before the Japanese reactors spun out of control. See why I like reading this. It's nicely written. In the early 1950s, the disciples of nuclear power, or the peaceful atom, as it was then called, insisted that nuclear power would soon become so cheap and efficient it would be offered to consumers for free. They actually said electricity would be too cheap to meter. Visionaries that they were, they suggested that cities would be constructed with building materials impregnated with uranium, so that snow removal would be unnecessary. Atomic bombs, they urged, should be used to carve out new coastal harbors for ships. Actually, you can look that up. They were going to use a series of four or five giant nuclear bombs to blow up part of Alaska to create a harbor. In low doses, they swore radiation was actually beneficial to one's health. They call that hormesis. Ann Coulter's a big fan. Such notions and outright fantasies, as well as propaganda for new industry and a new way of war, even if laughable today, is it? We're still living in it. Had tragic results back then. Thousands of American GIs, for instance, were marched into Ground Zero just after above-ground nuclear tests had been set off to observe their responses to what military planners assumed would be the atomic battlefield of the future. Ignorance, it turns out, is not bliss, and thousands of those soldiers later became ill. Many died young. That's radiation poisoning. Unwary, ask the guys who were there at Fukushima on the Navy battleship or destroyer trying to put out the fire. There are deaths. There are a child born to one of the guys died after having cancer and birth other problems. And I think the last report I read that there were 250 sick people. Unwary civilians. I can look that up later. You can look it up. Unwary civilians who lived downwind of America's Western testing grounds. Downwind is everywhere. Were also exposed to nuclear fallout, and they too suffered horribly from a variety of cancers and other illnesses. Uranium miners exposed to radiation in the tunnels where they wrestled from the earth raw materials for the nuclear age also became ill and died too soon, as did workers processing that uranium into weapons and fuel. Many of those miners were poor Navajos from my backyard in Utah, where the new uranium boom, part of the so-called nuclear renaissance, was, before Fukushima, set to take shape. Let's just pause here for a second. We're all downwind. There were 2,053 nuclear bombs set off in the atmosphere. We're all downwind. You wonder why cancer deaths have spiked all over the world. We're all downwind. How unlikely risks become inevitable. There's a book, a cataloging. I don't remember what it's called. I read it. I sat in a library and read it over like 5 days, 4 days. It just cataloged every series of nuclear tests and where the plumes went over the United States, because there were measurements. And you're talking about New York State, Maine, Florida, just, you know, depending on where they reached in the atmosphere, troposphere, etc. They were dropped, you know, the radiation was then dropped back down. So we were all sprinkled for 50 years with radiation. Serious. It's true. In the future, today's low-risk claims from industry advocates will undoubtedly seem as tragically naive as yesterday's false claims. Yes, the likelihood that any specific nuclear power plant reactor will melt down may be slim indeed, which hardly means inconceivable. But to act as though nuclear risks are limited to the operation of power plants is misleading in the extreme. Spent fuel from reactors, the kind burning in Japan, as he wrote this, is produced as a plant operates, and that fuel remains super hot and dangerous for hundreds, if not thousands, of years. Pause. Who lives that long? Nobody. Why are we doing this? Because we're crazy. We're a stupid monkey species that developed tools that we could not manage because we had oil, which gave us an ungodly power to do whatever we wanted on the surface and bowels of the earth. As we are learning to our sorrow at the Fukushima complex, such used fuel is hardly spent. Very important point. In fact, it can be even more radioactive. It is, and dangerous, than reactor cores. Yeah, that's right. Spent fuel continues to pile up in a nuclear waste stream that will have to be closely managed and monitored for eons. Thousands of years. Tens of thousands of years. A couple hundred thousand years. So long as those designing nuclear waste repositories struggle with a problem of signs that may be intelligible in a future so distant today's languages may not be understood. You might think that a danger dangerous enough to outlast human languages would be a danger to avoid. But the hubris, the massive ego of the human species, and he says of the nuclear accident, is equal to its willingness to deceive. But that's the problem of the whole human species. Writing about that since the time of it. I don't know. Aeschylus and Sophocles and so on. Euripides, Eumenides. A natural disaster, accident, or terrorist attack might be statistically unlikely in any year or decade, but becomes more likely in the half-century, century, or half-millennium mark. Given enough time, the unlikely becomes almost inevitable. Even if you and I are not the victims of some great future apocalyptic disturbance, well, we already are, of that lethal residue, to consign our children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, great-great-grandchildren to such peril is plainly and profoundly immoral. Well, let's not get on our high horse. It's going to kill us all. Nuclear proponents have long wanted to limit the... Really? It's not? What's happening in the Pacific Ocean? Nuclear... Oh, it's global warming, right? That's why there are deformations. That's why there are mystery diseases and pox all over the body and, you know, blackened organs. That's just heat. A little, like, 1 degree of excess heat. Okay, right. Nuclear proponents have long wanted to limit the discussion of risk to plant operation alone. Take this into consideration. Not to the storage of dangerous wastes. Get it? And they remain eager to ignore altogether the risks inherent in transporting nuclear waste, often called mobile Chernobyl by nuclear critics. Moving those spent rods, fuel rods, to future repositories represents a rarely acknowledged category of potential catastrophe. Let's take the word potential out of there. Just imagine a trainload of hot nuclear waste derailing along a major urban corridor in a city, along a city supply route from New York to Philadelphia to Baltimore to Washington, from Boston to New York, from Los Angeles to the Bay Area, from Las Vegas. Moving those spent fuel rods, because there are nuclear power plants all over the place, to future repositories represents a rarely acknowledged category of potential catastrophe. Just imagine a trainload of hot waste derailing along a major urban corridor and the ensuing evacuations of nearby inhabitants. Really? You're going to inhabit 30 million people living in some part of the country? To where? What island? It means, in essence, that one of those Fukushima pools of out-of-control waste could go nuclear anywhere in our landscape. Risk is about more than likelihood, writes Chip Ward. It's about impact. If I tell you that your chances of being bitten by a mosquito as you cross my yard are 1 in 100, you'll think that risk different than if I tell you the same odds that you have the same odds for a deadly pit viper in my yard. Or a nest of deadly pit vipers. Well, you have a 1 in 100 chance of falling into that pit. You know what? I'm not going to go out there. As events... Nuclear energy is a pit viper. You get it? As events unfold in Japan, it's even clearer that we're talking about pit viper. You wouldn't know it if you were to debate a nuclear industry representative. They constantly downplay both odds and impact and dismiss those who claim otherwise as hysterical doomsayers. Oh. Fukushima will remember the only people who... The real emergency in Chernobyl is fear and depression, anxiety and depression from people who are not in favor of nuclear power. You know, the only people who get hurt in a school shooting are people who are afraid of bullets. Fukushima will... Right? Right. Fukushima will assumedly make their task somewhat more difficult. Not really. Nobody's paying attention. The true cost of nuclear power costs are another subject carefully fudged and obscured by nuclear power advocates. From its inception in federally funded labs, nuclear power has been highly subsidized. A recent report by the Union of Concerned Scientists, well, they can't be trusted, clearly, found that more than 30 subsidies have supported every stage of the nuclear fuel cycle, from uranium mining to long-term waste storage. Added together, these subsidies have often exceeded the average market price for the power produced. Get it? Nuclear power isn't worth the energy it's produced. When it comes to producing electricity, these subsidies are so extensive, the report concludes, in some cases, it would have cost taxpayers less to simply buy the kilowatts on the open market and give them away. If the Nuclear Club in Congress, led by Senate Republican leader Mitch McConnell, gets its way, billions more in subsidies will be forthcoming, including massive federal loan guarantees to build the next generation of nuclear power plants. These are particularly important to the industry, since bankers won't otherwise touch projects that are notorious for mammoth cost overruns, lengthy delays, and abrupt cancellations. That's true. Look around at canceled nuclear power plants, stalled nuclear power plants. You find your dozen. mega projects. Coal may be ugly and may, you know, do terrible things to the environment. You could build a coal plant, burn the stuff, and spin a wheel and make electricity. Now, can you do the same with solar? All right, you get it. This I'm not going to read the whole article for you. It's Chip Ward, and the article is How the Peaceful Atom Became a Serial Killer. I recommend it. Let's see what time it is. Let's check the doomsday clock, see how much time we have. Good, just enough time to get into this. Well, Liam, enough doom and gloom. Solar will definitely save us, right? Of course it will. Book review of Spain's Photovoltaic Revolution, The Energy Return on Investment by Pedro Prieto and Charles Hall, 2013. Let's jump ahead. This is by Alice Friedman at Energy Skeptic with a K, energyskeptic.com. Tilting at windmills, Spain's disastrous attempt to replace fossil fuels with solar photovoltaics. I think I tipped my hat. Pietro, here we are. She writes, this is the first and only book to use massive amounts of real data, not models, when looking at the energy return, or they're going to say E-R-O-I, E-I-E-I-O, the energy return on the investment. You put in an investment, you get a certain amount back. If you put in one unit of energy, one barrel of oil, you get one barrel, you're not going to do it, one barrel back. You better get 10 barrels of oil back for the one that you put in, or 100. Early oil fields had got thousands of barrels of oil back for every barrel of oil that you put into drilling. Today's oil fields get 19. You can tell that we cannot maintain the society that we built getting thousands back on 19. Fracking gets 10. Tar sands get 3. We're grinding down close to that. We're not going to be doing it anymore level. This is the only estimate, writes Alice Friedman, of an energy return on invested study of solar photovoltaics based on real data. Other studies use models, or very limited data, further hampered by missing figures about lifespan, performance, and so on, that are often unavailable due to private proprietary nature of the solar PV companies, photovoltaics. Models often limit their life cycle analysis to the solar panels themselves, which represent only a third of the overall energy embodied in solar photovoltaic plants. These studies left out dozens of energy inputs, including leading to overestimates of energy, such as a payback time of 1 to 2 years and high ROI, high energy return of 8 or 5 to 10. Let's get ahead. Pietro and Hall in this study conclude that the energy return of solar is about 2.45. That's lower than tar sands. Very low, despite Spain's ideal sunny climate. Germany's energy return on solar is probably 20 to 33% less, 1.6 to 2. Due to less sunlight and less efficient rooftop installation. It's not saying that it's nothing. It's saying that it's not 100 or it's not 50. And it's saying that it won't, what I'm telling you is that it won't replace the automotive industry. It's not bad for putting in some electricity, but let's see. The gold rush to get the subsidy of 40, here it is. Spain saw much good coming from promoting solar power. There'd be long-term research and development, a Spanish solar industry, and many high-tech jobs created since the components for the solar plants would be manufactured locally. Spain imports 90% of its fossil fuels, more than any European nation, so this would lower expensive oil imports. To kickstart the solar revolution, the Spanish government promised a massive subsidy to solar plant providers at six times the cost of fossil fuel-generated electricity for 25 years. And 4.6, you get lost in these numbers. Doesn't matter. They offered them huge subsidies. Do this and you won't have to pay as much. You'll get, you know, good tax breaks and all the rest. The gold rush to get the subsidy of 47 euros per kilowatt hour began. Because the subsidy was so high, far too many solar PV plants were built quickly, more than the government could afford. This might not have happened if global banks hadn't gotten involved and handed out credit like candy. Even before the financial crash of 2008, which was based on our oil crash, really, the Spanish government began to balk at paying the full subsidies. We're not going to do it. Not going to do it. And after the 2008 crash, the government began issuing dozens of decrees lowering the subsidies and allowed profit margins. So they took back what they had offered. And the utilities were allowed to raise their electrical rates. The end was a massive transfer of public wealth to private solar PV investors of about 2.3 billion euros per year, and businesses that depend on cheap electricity threaten to leave Spain. Solar companies went bankrupt after the financial crash, including the Chinese company SunTech, which sold 40% of its product to Spain. About 44,000 of the nation's 58,000 PV installations are almost bankrupt. About 44 of the 58,000 PV installations are almost bankrupt. Companies continue to fall, sell Celis, or lay off many employees. Spanish photovoltaic module manufacturer T-Solar. Nor were new jobs, research, and development created, since most of the equipment and solar panels were brought from China. Prieto and Hall, the authors of the study, believe this fiasco could have been avoided if the Spanish government had invited energy and financial analysts to flow chart the many costs and energy inputs to save, to have more realistic understanding of what the cost would actually be. Germany is having a similar power fiasco. Germany spent 100 billion euros between 2000 to 2011. And let's quote the Der Spiegel article. You know, I'm not saying it's absolutely correct. Let's just look what they say. For weeks now, the 1 million solar power systems in Germany have generated almost no electricity. The days are short. The weather is bad and the sky is overcast. As is so often the case in winter, all solar panels are more or less stopped generating at the same time. To avert power shortages, Germany imports large amounts of electricity generated at nuclear power plants in France and the Czech Republic. Great. And, I mean, sorry, but great. Czech Republic. Birthplace of my great-grandparents. And powering an old oil-fired plant in the Austrian city of Graz. Solar farm operators and homeowners with solar panels on their roofs collected more than 8 billion euros in subsidies in 2011, but the electricity they generated made only about 3% of the total power at unpredictable times. The distribution networks are not designed to allow tens of thousands of solar panel owners to switch at will between drawing electricity from the grid and feeding power into it. Because there are almost no storage options, that's right, electricity cannot be stored except in expensive batteries made of cadmium, which is a limited resource, and lead. The excess energy has to be destroyed at substantial cost. You just got to give it away. Release it to the atmosphere. Under Germany's renewable energy law, each new system qualifies for 20 years of subsidies. A mountain of future payment obligations is beginning to take shape in front of consumer eyes. According to the Rhine-Westphalia Institute for Economic Research, the solar energy systems connected to the grid in 2011 alone will cost electric consumers about 18 billion euros in subsidy costs over the next 20 years. On and on and on it goes. So it is in Japan. One of the things that you don't get when looking at solar is how much energy. So let's look. Some energy statistics. The world burns 4,000 something joules, EJ, I don't know what that is, something joules of power, though after fossil fuels begin their steep decline, there will be 10 to 20 EJ, I don't know what that is, and something joules, megajoules per year. Anyways, we're going to be in decline. Very large oil fields provide 80% of our oil. They're declining from 2 to 20% per year, on average 6.7. Oil is the basis of 97% transportation. Spain is the second largest installation of PV on Earth. It provides about 10% of the world's PV power, but 10% of the world's photovoltaic power. But solar, it really provides less than 1% of the world's electrical power. Solar PV would have to cover 2,300 square miles to replace the energy of nuclear and fossil fuel plants, 2,300 miles. You'd also need the equivalent of 300 billion car batteries to store the power for nighttime consumers. In 2009, these plants generated 2.26% of Spain's electricity, the largest percent of any nation on Earth. Not bad. In 2009, these plants generated 2.26. Not bad. For putting the country into debt, not good. For costing more than could be paid back, not good. Electric photovoltaic shouldn't be built to replace coal and gas-formed electricity. And it will have no impact at all on automotive. Automotive goes away when oil goes away. It just goes away. It's gone. We'll have other kinds of fuel to run machines if we're smart and build diesel machines now that for public use that can run on hemp and other biofuels. But we're not going to have cars. And that's not going to happen immediately. I mean, this is a long downgrade, so don't get the wrong idea. I'm not saying it's all over at once. All right. You've been listening to the Liam Scheff Show on Truth Frequency Radio and UCY TV. We will be back next week with more. We will continue the analysis of solar. I just wanted to give you a little taste of some of the problems that you run into. We barely scratched the surface. We'll scratch more surfaces. Next time, please support independent journalism. Buy my book, Official stories exist to protect officials. You will not be sorry. You will learn a lot. You will laugh quite a bit. And then you will pull your pants up. No! See you next time.